to hit record because there was so much going on. So we don't need the intro anyways. Who cares? This is the part that we need to know, right? All right, so once I can get my screen to change, which I'm learning with technology. Oh, too fast. There we go. It's fun. Technology is so much fun when you're trying to do a whole bunch of things. Before I get into the show, I want to take the time to thank Pierre Vegas Thibault, the main man who brought DiversityInTheCapital.tv to life last June. It's hard to think that it's going to be a year, and we're almost up to 700 likes. Thank you, and that's a lot to do with Drake Jensen and Patrick Massey. I thank you guys very, very much. Massey, sorry, I've been saying it right the whole day and I forgot. It's one of the many stations that's owned and operated by Gatineau.tv, which stemmed from the original Montreal channel, Montreal.tv. Je vous dis un gros merci pour nous laisser fournir l'information sur le réseau pour les LGBTQ. Pierre, I look forward to getting back into the community once we are released. Pour les amis à Gatineau, vérifiez vos télés sur Vidéotron la semaine du 16 avril sur le poste de MaTV. Il y aura un reportage sur moi et André sur le processus de devenir Miss Horizon. Somebody got the Facebook Live on at the same time. You have to turn the volume down, boys.
Sorry.
It's all good. It's fun learning, eh?
I was just posting it on my page, on my Facebook, to say we're live on your page right now.
Well, we are live, indeed. And now it's time to introduce this hot man. Now I need to release myself from the camera because cancel spotlight. I want this guy to do a little bit of chatting. Hey, Drake Jensen.
Hello.
My first guest is Drake Jensen. While presently working on his all-Canadian cover vinyl record, you heard that right, a big, huge vinyl record, and I have lots of them, so I hope you come out and go out and get one. Drake continues to be an LGBTQ+ advocate and musical leader in Canada's LGBTQ2+ community. Drake is most excited to talk to you all about his new and upcoming projects while joining his brother outlaw and company, Patrick Massey, to talk about music, the world, and getting through this difficult time in our lives. You can check out his website at drakejensen.ca. Drake, how's it going, Daddy?
It's good. It's going well. Locked up. Having fun.
Yes. Well, thank you so much for being here.
You're welcome. Thank you for having us on. Yeah. We appreciate it. We got through the technical difficulty part, and now we're good.
It's the live industry. You guys know all about that. Yeah. But everything goes right at all times, right?
Nope.
So we spoke a few months ago. Do you have an update for us on your vinyl record? I noticed you released one of the songs yesterday.
Well, I didn't release a song yet. So what's happening is what we're kind of thinking about right now. So everybody on the team, I have one more meeting tomorrow, and then we're going to be talking about maybe releasing a song every month as the songs are completed from the record, because we do have one completed now. It's Gordon, as you've seen on my Facebook page, Gordon Lightfoot's Sundown is now complete.
Yeah.
So I have one more meeting tomorrow with a new person on my team, and we're going to talk about when we're going to be releasing, but it's going to be soon.
Well, I can't wait. I cannot wait for that. And you might be singing us a little, well, you are, you're not might. You will be singing us a little diddly later on. And I can't
will.
Wait for that.
Yep, I will.
Wow, there's lots of comments already. There's Aaron, Greg, and Celeste Francois, happy birthday. Brian Mitchell, happy birthday. Drake, happy birthday. It's also Patrick Massey's birthday too, but that's in 2 days from now. But we're going to sing them a little happy birthday a little later on. So get your vocal cords ready, folks. Drake, do you have any new projects coming up?
No, mostly just a new record. I mean, I had a brand new video two new videos actually we were going to film in May.
Yeah.
But since we have to be so far away from each other, it's impossible right now.
Yeah, so, it's going to take a little more time for that, right?
Yeah. So I think what we're going to be doing is maybe as I release the singles from the Iconic record, I think Joe Grimshaw, who is my graphic designer, conspirator, I think we might be doing lyric videos, because a lot of people like lyric videos. They like sing-along videos. So we'll probably post some lyric videos. So that's something that, you know, during this time, I mean, basically everybody kind of has to, we all have to adjust to something very new.
Yeah, it's and I think this will change life as we know it, really. We have no choice. I mean, Mother Earth is rejuvenating itself, which is somewhat good. But, you know, I mean, in one way, it brought people back to reality and said, look, chillax a little.
Slow down.
And I think this is what, I mean, it's not what the world needed, but, I mean, we're not going to get political, and I don't want to get into all that. It's a very sad and scary time. So
it is. I mean, but the other thing, too, is unfortunately for mental health aspects, we all have to, like, do things that are going to make us feel better, whether that's, like somebody said, I do jumping jacks. I mean, I totally get it. I used to go to the gym constantly, and I can't go now.
No. We've been going for walks just to get out of the house to see, like, I mean, I don't know how many times I've seen my neighborhood now, but at least it's getting us out of the house for a little bit.
See, I have to be really careful, because Doug Ford had talked this week about you can take it on your shoes into your house. And the problem with me is I had double pneumonia when I was five. Most people don't know this, but I had double pneumonia when I was five. I had pneumonia last year, and I also have acute bronchitis. I've developed that through the years of having pneumonia. So I have to be really careful. I have to literally stay in all the time for the next 3 weeks.
So do I. I'm allergic to the pneumonia medication, so I'm even more SFA.
Oh, yeah. So you have to be careful. You have to be careful of your shoes. It's weird. It stays on the bottom of your shoes.
And apparently it stays in the air, too. So don't go directly behind someone. Walk beside them on the side.
No hookups on Grindr either.
I know those idiots, but I'm sure there's probably some of them still doing it. Whatever.
Yeah.
How's it being 50 so far? Are you liking it?
You know, I'm kind of glad you brought it up, because, I mean, my goal for being 50 was to be in a place where, you know, because I have a psychologist actually, who's wonderful, that I'm still continuing with, because I believe that our mental health is just as important as our physical health. But a lot of people were talking. I remember watching a YouTube video that said, you know, a lot of people are unhappy right now because they have this sense of desperation that they haven't done what they wanted to do.
Yeah.
Over the past 8 years, I mean, I've been really fortunate to be able to do what I wanted to do and to live my dream. I've performed across the world. I've filmed videos in LA and North Carolina, and I've been in the UK for the inclusion of the David Bowie book. I went across Canada, sang my way across Canada on Via Rail. I had a top 40 hit in Australia. I'm one of the most played LGBTQ male artists in Canada on radio. So I've done all these things that I'm happy for. So at 50, I got to tell you, it wasn't the way that I thought I was going to celebrate my 50th birthday. I was going to have a big get together and have a little, I was going to have a concert.
Yeah, we were going to have a show too, and then it got postponed, and
this
is the best I can do for you for now.
But for 50, I think my new thing at 50 is going to be an inspiration for people that are 50.
Exactly.
I mean, I really want to show people that, okay, so if you haven't done what you wanted to do up till now and you are 50, then go ahead and do what you want to do. I mean, it's, you know, I am who I am. That's one thing about me. I'm very opinionated. I managed to work very hard over the past 8 years and done some pretty amazing things that I never thought I could do. And now I want to be an inspiration to gay men that are my age.
That's good. That's very good. Well, I salute you. And I've done a few events with you. And I've been to several events where I've heard you sing. And I cannot wait for you to sing later on with your Outlaw in Crime. And speaking of your Outlaw in Crime, it's now time to meet Patrick Massey.
Hello.
Hi, Patrick. How are you?
I'm well. Thank you for having me on. It's awesome.
Oh, thank you for coming. Oh my goodness, my computers are going crazy. There's a sexy Patrick. Oh. All right. Canadian West Coast recording artist and songwriter Patrick Massey has been a constant in the Canadian country music scene since the release of his 1998 debut album, Get There From Here, which garnered him a nomination for the prestigious BCCMA Ray Macaulay Horizon Award. You can find him on all the music platforms, iTunes, YouTube, Spotify, and many others. You can check out his website, patrickmassey.com. How's it going, Patrick? Nice to meet you.
It's going really good. Yeah. Yeah.
How are
just hanging out on the West Coast.
Yeah.
It's good. Yeah. Things are going well. I mean, it's, you know, a lot of anxiety these days with the world, but, you know, we're just powering through and just learning how to pivot, right? And with your career, and
we all have to
all
adapt.
You can do.
Yeah. And lots of card games. I learned Skip-Bo on my phone now too. So my partner and I have a healthy little online competition at Skip-Bo. He wins all the time. He cheats. So I don't know. All right. So can you explain to me what BCCMA stands for?
Yeah, the BCCMA is the BC Country Music Association.
Oh, yes.
And I kind of left the sort of country music industry for quite a few years. In 2002, I walked away from a major record deal in Nashville because they wanted me to stay in the closet. And the country community, and Drake can testify to this, is not the most open-minded genre. So I kind of left it for like a good 14, 15 years. And then I reconnected with some people I knew that were on the board, and they asked me to run. And I ran, and I'm in my second year term now. So I'm the artist relations and sponsorship director. And so I, my goal to get on it was to push inclusivity and diversity and to make it more open, like for anybody, because I don't want anyone to feel how I was made to feel, right? When
yes.
I was alienated, ostracized from the industry. So I've really been pushing that agenda with the BCCMA, and you know, it's 43 years we've been around, we just you know, we nurture and foster country music, and promote it, you know, provincially, nationally, and globally. So it's kind of full circle. It's come back. I never in a million years thought that I would be not only back with the BCCMA, but on the board of directors. So it's quite interesting.
Cool. Very cool. Yeah. Your second album, Mend the Man, charted two singles in 2009. Extensive airplay of your two albums has earned you a loyal fan base and established you as an artist who constantly stands on the leading edge of inclusivity. Your recent single, A Little Bit of Saturday, which you co-wrote, was produced with Kaya Productions.
Kuya. Yeah.
Kuya, best known for working with Alicia Cara, JRDN, Sean Desmond, and Kelly Clarkson. That's impressive.
Jordan.
Jordan? Well, there's an O missing.
He spells his name different, isn't it?
Oh, like, does he?
Spelling? Yeah. Interesting. Bobby and Sammy are two brothers, and their production company is called Kuya. And Kuya in Filipino means brother. So that's their two brothers, and they, my management brought, I was doing like really, really traditional country music, like so much that country was like, you're too country for country, like country radio wouldn't.
You're never too country.
You know, because I grew up on that, and I loved like the fiddle and the steel guitar and all that. And so it was interesting. And then I was doing a showcase at Canadian Music Week, and I'd been with my manager for quite a few years, but I'd never met her business partner and her husband. They had never heard me sing. So I go into this, you know, industry stuff, open bar. So everybody's there, 5 p.m. after work, everybody's talking. And I go, and it was Alan Threw, the guys from Glass Tagger.
Okay.
Were, like Alan Threw was hosting the event. And it was all a bunch of young, like 20-year-old kids, right? This is about 5 years ago,
yes.
or 4 years ago. And I was... technical difficulty.
Well, thank you for that shot.
So Alan calls me up and he's like, can I say you're the most seasoned performer? Because they were all 20-year-olds, right? And I was, and so I go up and it was just guitar vocal, and the whole room stopped and listened. And it was like a very humbling experience. And then Mark and Stefan at the time, Bev's partners, were like, I think why are you fighting for this traditional, there's nothing really traditional about you, like, no. You know, being gay in country music, and, you know, and so they brought Kuya and I together, and my manager called me, and she's like, you have to come to Toronto, paid for, and you have 3 days to write 3 hit songs, and they don't really, they're uncomfortable with you. And I was like,
oh my goodness.
I was losing my mind. So we go into the studio, and within 45 minutes, we wrote the first song, Let's Ride. And it was just like kismet. It was like unbelievable.
How do you find it writing for, like producing on your own as to working with a big record producer like Kuya?
It's a different experience. I mean, you know, because, I mean, there when you deal with, like, producers on that level, they're so commercialized, right? So it was a different experience. I'd never wrote, like, we wrote a line and recorded it. I'd never recorded a record that way before.
Yeah.
And then after I did it, I was like, how the hell am I going to sing this song? It is so wordy. Where do I breathe? I was like, and it was a different, completely different experience. And it kind of branched. I told Bobby and Sammy, I said, hey, listen, if you want to, like, continue to songwrite or make money, you need to start going to Nashville and start, you know, getting into that realm. Because, and so they went down there, and I then heard they played my tracks and landed Kelly Clarkson. And I was like,
wow.
I was
love
like,
her.
Because I love Kelly Clarkson.
Yeah, she's amazing.
She's such a strong woman, you know, like,
yeah.
And I love that, you know, and, it's the same in country music, right? Like there's this aversion to women. They don't want to play women singers on country radio. They really don't at
it's
all.
Not the most popular.
No, it's in the last 10 years, they've really pushed women out of country radio. It's real. Like Drake, you can speak to this, right? I mean, it's awful. I mean, what they're doing. I mean,
well, I think that, you know, and I have this thing with a lot of gay people too. They say the same thing. Oh, you know, you're in country music. We feel alienated from country music. I'm like, well, you know, Patrick and I are here, and there's others in the States that I'm not going to mention. But he looks
really good in his underwear though today, Drake. I must say.
Stop! Don't even go there. I'm going to need a drink if you're going to tell. I'm not getting in my underwear. But
not you.
No,
the unmentionable.
I do. Look
what I got though. Look what I have.
Oh, 15 fabulous.
15 and fabulous. So I'm going to wear this because Michael bought this for me.
Oh,
that's awesome.
So everybody's, I've been called a big queen before. So fuck you guys. This is my big sash.
She's in the pageant.
I am now.
There you go.
But the thing is, I think that, you know, a lot of people feel alienated from country, but the problem now is the gay population can say they're alienated from country, but country's really not country anymore. Country's rap. We have a very new generation of country, and a lot of people are coming back to it. I mean, a lot of gay people came back to it. I know because of Patrick and I's music. And other people like Ty Herndon, of course, Shelley Wright, I'm going to say it. And I can't say Steve Grant because Steve Grant's not country, even though they tag him country. But, you know, between Ty Herndon and Shelley Wright, who started in the States, and then Patrick and I here in Canada, I think that's, you know, it's been a very, very tough road, and it's difficult. And women have the same kind of issue, like Patrick was saying. I mean, you've got artists like Michelle Wright, who I grew up listening to, who's absolutely stellar.
I haven't heard her in a long time either, actually.
Well, the reason why you haven't heard from her in a long time is that she's been putting records out. Radio won't play her.
Wow.
Yeah, radio won't play her. She had a couple of really good singles out. And if you look her up, so go look her up. But, you know, she can't get radio play anymore.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, if there's 20 songs in an hour, there's probably 2 females and 18 men.
Yeah, and it's all about trucks and tailgates and... And
the bro country thing. And you know what's interesting is, like, 15 years ago, that's what I wanted to do. I didn't want to stand behind, you know, a mic with a guitar and, you know, just stand there. I wanted to be a performer. And they're like, you can't do that. It's too faggy. You can't do that.
Because
and
it wasn't the country music standard of, like, Grand Ole Opry or whatever, right?
Right. And now jump 15 years later, they're all like,
yeah,
Brian and all of them, they're doing the bro country, and they're all dancing around in their women's jeans. It's kind of ironic, you know. It's just like, I don't get it. I mean,
I don't know about, you know, I won't speak for you, Patrick, but my music's kind of morphed. It's starting to become more adult contemporary than it is country.
And right, you know? I mean, as long as you can, there's been so many mixes, like Little Nas. He took that country song, but he's more country, rap, pop, you know, Old Town
Road. I'm not sure.
Really? Well, I'm really not sure about that award either. So here's my opinion on this. Okay, I'm going to be political. Go figure. no. So they created the Event of the Year Award. What kind of award is that towards somebody's talent? What does that say get to somebody as far as their talent goes to get an Event of the Year Award?
They always had that. Like, it was the vocal of, like, the duet event.
Okay.
That's what they won, Billy Ray Cyrus and Little Nas? Yeah, Little Nas.
Yeah. Nas X.
I'll be very honest. I pay about 1% attention to new country. I don't pay very much attention to it at all. I find it, you know, when I'm creating new music, especially like now, we're creating a very different record than we ever have.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of synths on it. I like Rob Prews from Honeymoon Suite. And of course of the Spoons is on this record, and he's brought a very interesting technical dimension. And I'm playing synths on this record also. It's going to be a very different sounding record than anything I made before. That's for sure.
Well, I cannot wait. I know some of the songs are on it, and I really can't wait for it. So,
well, it's a cover record. It's all Canadian. I really wanted to do an all Canadian cover record, and I really think that, you know, Canada is doing such a great job right now of leading the way as far as unity and organization and how our leaders are really there for us at the moment. I'm very proud in 2020 to be releasing an all Canadian cover record.
Yeah,
I cannot wait. I want mine signed too as well. So
of course,
getting one. All right, let's do a little bit of hot topics, shall we?
Uh-oh.
So I know Drake might want to comment on this one a little more. But do you want to talk moistly to me? Does the PM turn you on in that picture? Have you seen the picture of the PM sexy all on a chair and?
You're first, Pat. You're going first on this one, not me.
Well, I mean, I think it was funny. I think, you know, like Justin Trudeau, Prime Minister Justin Trudeau. It's so weird because I've met him so many times, and it's so weird. I thought he handled it because when he said it, then he was like, "Wow, that was what did he say? That was awkward, or that was, you know, like it was funny. It was like, but you know, like Drake. To go back to what Drake was saying, it's a very amazing time to be a proud Canadian right now. Really is, you know, and I think what's going on and what all levels of government are doing in this country is commendable. And it's you know, it's one of those things that when I tour anywhere I go, I always wear a Canadian flag pin. I'm very happy and proud.
We have the lowest numbers, so people in Canada are listening.
Yes.
Stay the blaze in the home. Yes. I like that from the East Coast. I mean, instead of swearing, like, stay the blazing home. Come on.
I like swearing, though.
Yeah, I know.
That's a very Maritimer expression, though, isn't it, Drake?
Yes.
Blazes, stay the blazes at home. That's kind of Newfoundland more than anything, I think.
Yeah, I think it's the Newfoundland premier that said it.
But kind of like how
that was in New Brunswick. That was the premier of New Brunswick.
Oh, was it New Brunswick?
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah. Stay the blazes.
Stay the blazes home.
Stay the blazes home. I think, I mean, that all that stuff kind of stems back from the UK,
They're going to the bar.
We're going to the bar. How's she going? How's the quarantine going by?
Well, very unfortunate. They just got the first case on Cape Breton Island, I think, today.
We got this. Did you gentlemen watch this the Modern Family finale? 11 seasons of Modern Family.
You need to talk about this one.
No, I never watched it either. No.
Oh yeah.
Well, I've never watched that show.
It was all right. I thought it would have ended on a bigger bang, but it was pretty good. So check out 11 seasons of Modern Family. If you've never watched it, you should.
Now you're always waiting for things for to end on a bigger bang. I know you very well. I mean, so it was probably very good. It's just that you like things big with a big bang.
That's why I've got a house now. The Masked Singer. Do you guys watch that? Are you following that?
Say that again.
Masked Singer.
No, never seen it.
Oh my God! You guys are music guys. Like, you should be able to tell who everybody is under those masks.
No, you know, the only Masked Singer I know is Orville Peck. that's the only Masked Singer that I know of. I mean, but no, what is it? Do tell. So this is
So the Masked Singer is like celebrities from all walks of life that put a big mask on. There's a spaceman. There's the Night Angel. Oh my God! There was a swan at one point, and they sing, and they have to guess. There's four judges. There is
Jenny McCarthy.
Bird Lines dude, Dr. Ken, the Pussycat Girl, and
Nicole Schlussel.
Nicole Scherzinger. That's it. And anyway, so I think one of them is Julie Black, but they've had. Oh my God, they've had some amazing people. Sarah, what's her name there from Alaska?
Oh yeah.
Governor Sarah Palin.
Sarah Palin, yeah. Oh wow.
Last season they had,
Did she leave her rifle at home?
could she see Poland when she was singing?
Possibly.
That was Russia.
And so you and Michael must be happy that Hallmark was bringing back Christmas movies.
Yeah, Michael, Hallmark's bringing back Christmas movies.
I saw it. I don't know if they did or not, but so Santa might be very popular again. That'll bring it into your royalties, won't it?
Yeah, so Michael will probably be on again because it was a Christmas scavenger hunt was his movie, so he'll probably do a rerun for that.
Yes, well, and folks, if you haven't seen the scavenger hunt yet, please check it out because our very own Michael from Ottawa is Santa. So make sure you check that out.
I'm Mrs. Claus, you know. I'm Mrs. Claus.
You're Mrs. Claus?
Yeah.
You're Mrs. Something.
My birthday. I will take over the show.
There you go.
I have the
It's
thatch.
Not your birthday yet. It's not till the 15th.
Oh, yes. Well, it's both your birthdays. So before we go on, I'm going to get the crowd because they're not going to hear it, but you're basically just going to hear me. And we're going to sing some happy birthday to you. So if everybody wet your whistles on the count of three, sing out from your home to make sure that Drake and Patrick can hear you. One, two, three. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Dear Drake and Patrick, happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, boys. Yay. Oh, thank you.
That's Woo. Awesome.
For saying a happy birthday.
Thank you so much. That's awesome.
You're welcome. Well, thank you so much. You can check these two gentlemen out all on social media. Patrick, for more information, visit his website, patrickmassey.com. Or head on over to Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, or his Twitter page. And Drake Jensen is also, he's on Spotify. He's on all the music channels. DrakeJensen.com?
DrakeJensen.com.
Yep.
.ca.
You're so Canadian, hey, Drake?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, Drake?
The website is, the website was just completely revamped, actually.
Yeah, it looks great.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, Bobby Nelson did that for me. He did a great job between Bobby Nelson and Joe Grimshaw. They did a great job of that.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. I called Clark to do a subscribe button just like you. So I'm copying you, Drake. Sorry.
But the thing is,
I lost my database when I left my management because they had it. So I don't have
just start a new one. All you have to do is start a new one, and I'm encouraging everybody to sign up to mine because the interesting thing is. All the people that are signed up to my mailing list on my website are going to get to hear every single from Iconic first.
Oh,
that's awesome.
Yes, I'm so glad I'm one of them.
Yay! Yes. And if you guys are out there listening, please like me or follow me on Spotify. I need to get more followers. I'm pathetic.
I'm going to put those in the link after the show. I'm going to put links to all of you. So make sure you guys send me an email with all your links so I can paste them on. Okay. Next week, we have our first 50 Shades episode featuring the one and only Jesse Reynolds talking about his podcast with his co-host Jenna Mosher. And they got a chance to speak with Kirstie Alley last week. And he's had a tweet from Wendy Williams. Well, you'll have to tune in next week to see what that's all about. And of course, there's Mama Vaselina C. Thorne, Queen of the Snow Pride and Mercury Lounge Wednesdays. We love to hump. We will try and find out her deepest, darkest secrets in her skeleton closet. So make sure you stick around next week for that. Hopefully, Facebook Live won't give me any problems. And
I hope not.
Time.
Are we answering questions today?
Yeah, you did some.
Oh, no, I mean, I thought you were talking to people that were online.
Yes. Well, there was a few, so let's go through some of those now. From Boy Quentin, can I say I love Drake's Stop Talking shirt?
Oh, it's called Stop Talking, You're Making Me Famous.
Oh,
is an original from State of Mind on Davey. My good friends, Sandra Skinner and Linda, 27 years they had that clothing store standalone, and it was amazing. And I went in with, I had the shirt, and Drake,
I think the day we went in was they were closing.
They retired, but of course they haven't really.
Nobody else took the store over. They had nice
always Vistaprint.
Yeah. Well, yeah, but it's a really great thing because everybody reads it.
It came from a store in BC, right?
I don't want anybody to stop talking about me. I don't care what they're talking.
In the Davie Village, right on Davie, yeah. State of Mind. It was there for 27 years. It was like, I think, a standalone clothing store for 27 years. That's pretty amazing. Yeah.
Mario Cugliata saying hello to Patrick. Ryan Weeks, yay, is all excited. Who else we got? Oh, some people's computers keep freezing. Hi, Sammy Blackwood. Hi, Brian Mitchell. Is the world resetting itself? Yes, I think
yes.
Drake, a question for you. When did you start singing?
I was 4 years old in preschool. I think they called it nursery school on Cape Breton. And everybody had to do something for graduation from nursery school into grade primary. And I was asked to do it, something, and I said, well, I want to sing, because I was in love with John Denver.
Wow.
I was literally in love with John Denver. I mean, when I look back, I was...
John Denver? Really?
Yeah, like, I love John Denver. I had a real crush on John Denver.
Country road.
That's what I sang. West Virginia. Blue Ridge Mountains. Yeah, see, it sounded a lot different back when I was five, though.
What's the other one? Sunshine on my shoulders makes me happy.
Yeah. Take us all out to the back of the bar and shoot us.
Yeah, we should have a sing-along. That's what we should do.
Yeah. Patrick, when was your, when did you first start singing?
I started when I was 14, I think. Around then, I wrote a song. I can't remember the artist, but I had a cassette. That's how old I am. And MCA Records. And when I was 13, I was asking for an electric Smith Corona typewriter for Christmas. How obviously I was a fag. What 13? So I started writing letters, and I sent my song. And for whatever reason, Kathy Gibbings, I'll never forget, the assistant A&R director of MCA Records Canada, started writing me letters, and she I would write to her and to Ed McMahon to get on
Ed McMahon is what Ellen is now, really, the person can make everything happen, right?
Is there who else is there? Is there anybody else asking questions? I always like people's questions.
So John Koomstra, happy special man, Drake Jensen. Happy, soon to be happy birthday, Patrick Massey. So I think that was a happy birthday.
Thank you very much, John. Love you very much.
Thank you.
You've made me rediscover country music.
Yay.
Hey, see, that's what we like to hear.
I would love to see you if you do a few karaoke videos. Well, the guys are going to sing in a few minutes. They're going to sing live.
Well, I'm going to sing, and Patrick's going to do something along. His allergies are really bad, and he's, I think.
Yeah, I can't. Yeah, I get it.
Well, my song is going to be even worse after that, so don't feel bad.
But we will be really soon. Drake, can I announce what we're doing?
Can we tell them?
Yeah, go for it.
Should we tell them? We're doing another duet.
Ooh, which one?
We're going to do a cover of Lost in Love, Air Supply.
That is an amazing song.
Yeah. But we're fighting over who's doing what part.
Oh, yeah.
We're not fighting. I thought we already...
I'm joking. we're supposed to have some drama.
Oh, no. Oh, no.
Yeah. You're too far to claw each other's eyes out. So you gotta
We need to get like the Kardashians, right?
Yes.
And then everything comes together in the end and everybody's happy.
Exactly.
Yes. But anyway, I think Patrick's going to take the lead on this one. So.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right. Well, are you guys ready to sing us a little song?
We're ready.
Well, Drake's going to sing. I'm not.
So it's now time for Drake to bring a little smile to your faces. Yeah. It's his birthday and he's performing on his own birthday. So let's hope it's something to make your heart smile, hopefully. So we like to take the last 15 minutes of the show for musical performances because we know how Facebook loves to cut sound out. So that's why this will be posted on YouTube after, and then it will be shared on the diversityinthecapital.tv Facebook page. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you are ready for the birthday boys to serenade you. Drake, take it away. I'm going to shut my screen off so you get the full screen on this one.
Oh no! A full screen. So?
Go ahead. Tell
them about the song and how the song started. I'm not getting a full screen here for some reason, though, Andre.
Oh, yeah, I was hiding myself.
All I see is Ms. Horizon. She looks good, though. She looks real. Oh, there I am. Okay, yeah. So, a little story about this song. This song was written by Tia McGrath, who was a great friend of mine from Port Dover, Ontario, and she's really helped me along over the years in my career. Thanks, Tia. Thanks, Tommy, her husband, Tommy. So, Tommy, Tom, Tia McGrath, and Kevin Fisher got together in LA and they wrote this song and so kindly sent it to me. And when I heard it, actually I didn't hear it. Jonathan said, did you listen to that song that Tia sent? And I was like, no. I said, I didn't. He said, you better listen to it. He said, it's such a great song. So I listened to the song and then Patrick and I had always talked about like working together. And I thought this was the perfect song to share with him because it was the message that basically we both promote. And of course the song is, this is a different version of. A latchkey bully kid picked on closeted, totally scared to death. Listens to the experts say it gets better, but nothing's getting better yet. So when's a little kindness ever gonna find us and lead the way? Man, if that were my kid, he would be protected and hear me say, go your own way. Here and gone, your life's a song, it's yours alone. Don't be afraid to go your own way. Damn those magazines, killing my self-esteem. Nobody's perfect like that. It's nothing but Photoshop. I'm getting off the chopping block and put away my yoga mat. I'm gonna
gonna take a long walk and have a little God talk and hear him say, look at what I gave you, I'm the one that made you, and you're okay. So go your own way. Be whoever you are. Like a snowflake, time is here and gone. Your life's a song that yours alone. Don't be afraid to go the wrong way.
Go your own way.
Go your own. Go your own. Go your own way.
Go your own way.
Go your own way. And be whoever you are. Like a snowflake. Here and gone, your life's a song that yours alone. Don't be afraid to go, go your own way.
Yay!
A little different version.
So make sure you all go to Spotify, check out Drake Jensen's page and Patrick Massey's as well. They both have amazing music on there, so make sure you check it out. So now I am going to figure out why my computer is playing with me. And I am going to sing a song for you.
Yay.
I can get this. Oh. See, it's the first time I've got a new toy.
I know you have to do a Nana Mouskouri song for me. Because you look like Nana Mouskouri tonight. You look beautiful.
Why is it?
Nickels and dimes.
Did Rise not look like Nana Mouskouri tonight? Yeah, she needs to do a Nana Mouskouri song. I had a big crush on Nana Mouskouri.
What was it? Nickels and dimes. Nickels and dimes.
That's one of my favorites, nickels and dimes, yes.
Joan E. Joan E. Do you know Joan E?
Yes.
Joan E?
Joan yeah. E, yes.
Drag queen from Vancouver, originally from Calgary.
Yes.
No.
She Joan E used to do that song of the original Odyssey, and people would throw nickels, like, hot the matter. It was terrible. Yeah. It's like Travis Tritt had to stop singing here's a quarter, call someone who cares, because people used to throw the quarters and injure him.
Yeah. Oh yeah, no doubt.
Yeah.
Ow, that would hurt me.
That would Bastards. Hurt me. All right. I'm not sure if this is going to work, but it's my turn to sing.
Yay!
I'm gonna sing a song. This is the time, people, where you need to turn your volumes down.
No.
Turn them way down.
Don't just be a little so warning. Hard on yourself, darling.
All the colors of the rainbow, all the voices of the wind. Every dream then reaches out, reaches out to find what love begins. Every word of every story, every star in every sky, every corner of creation is to testify. every breath I take, will give thanks to God above. For as long as I shall live, I will testify to love.
Well, the modulation is the modulation is the hard part.
It is.
I mean, it's pretty, and it's pretty hard. Winona is probably one of the best singers of all time, in my opinion. I mean,
but you know what, Andre? Andre, Ms. Horizon, sorry. You have a very good voice.
Oh, yes.
Thank you. I know I haven't been pulling it out, and then I've sang a couple at the show, and I'm like, you know what? Instead of just keep doing drag,
well, I mean, there's
get back into it.
There's also other circumstances happening now that are that are affecting your voice greatly.
Yes. Yeah. So. Affecting a lot of things in my body. Like when you and your boyfriend go get drugs downtown, like medication from Shoppers, and there's not one effing bathroom open downtown, and then your stomach tells you it's time now.
Yeah, no, I know.
No.
I mean, have you talked
traveling after chemo.
Have you talked publicly? Do people know what's going on? Or?
Oh, yeah. I'm very open about the cancer treatment. Done 6 already, or 7 yesterday, so I have 5 more left.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure. I'm not seeing that much change, so I'm hoping that I'm going to be seeing the doctor soon, but I'm assuming it might be continuing after that. It's not the worst treatment that I'm getting either, so.
No, I mean, the thing is that look how great you look, though.
Oh, I'm still working too, and people are like, "Wow, why are you still working?" I mean,
the fact that you can sing like that one day after you've had your when did you have your chemo?
Yesterday.
So you had chemo yesterday, and you're up there singing today.
Yeah.
I couldn't do that. Sorry, I give you props. So
I came home from chemo yesterday, and I kept cleaning up my my little studio here, and
which looks fabulous. Start
and stop. You know, it's not something I can't do things for a long period of time anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah. But you also have a great outlook and positive attitude, right? Which is a big part of that whole process, right?
You know, and so
you have to.
We all love you very much, and all the community are behind you. So.
Oh, thank you. I love you guys. Yeah, I'm so happy that you guys were here.
And I mean it. I mean it when I say that you are probably one of my favorite, most professional people in the LGBTQ community in Ottawa. So. You've done a great job of bringing people together without a pile of drama. So, and you've always been nothing but a consummate professional. So on my 50th birthday, I'm very grateful for somebody like you in the community. So
thank you
very much.
I've been there. I've done that. I've done the hardcore drugs. I've done the, and I don't put up with it anymore. Like,
were you a whore? No, I don't believe that for a second.
I have bowling pins and my friends are convinced that I use them for other things.
Man, I'm a story can do things like that.
I'm not that. Folks, relax. No.
What end? I was kidding.
Patrick Massey, you're terrible.
Yeah, it's a double M.
Have you met me?
I have now. I don't know. Is there anything else you guys want to add before we end off? Anything you want to plug? Or
I don't know. I just wanted to add that, of course, I'm recording the new record with Jonathan Edwards, and I did ask him to come on, but Jonathan's very shy and he doesn't like to do stuff like this. He's the guy in the studio behind the panel, and that's where he likes to be.
Well, he asked.
He's fantastic, Jonathan.
Capital clip that we did.
Yeah,
Jonathan is a gem of a person, man. He's an awesome guy. Awesome.
Jonathan's a great guy. But Jonathan's so busy with Iconic, the new record, that I'm going to be working with John Hemingway producing this brand new Air Supply cover that Patrick and I are going to do together.
Wow.
So
are you you can't put it on that record because it's not Canadian.
Yeah. See, that's the thing. So we're going to do it as a separate project, Patrick and
I. You could do it as a hidden track maybe or something, you know, who knows?
Yeah. I think people are going to, this will be interesting to take such an old song and do something new with it.
It's
amazing
song though, eh? Like, yes. You know?
Yeah.
It's funny. It was the other day, right? When we were having our other meeting.
Yeah.
When I sang it, you're like, yeah. And then it's perfect for us. I mean,
yeah.
And at least we brought it down so you don't have to grab your balls.
Well, you know what?
Just sing that up.
I watched that. I sent you that clip of them doing it like not long ago, and he doesn't sing it that high anymore. So, and it works.
Yeah. Even in the live concert one, right? It was down. It's not as high as it was in the original, was it?
No, because, the one thing about you as you age is that I'm very fortunate. Yeah. I mean, I'm 50 now, and I still have the range I had when I was 25. I mean, I also use my voice very carefully.
Yeah.
So, well, your voice drops as you get older, right? Yeah. So
a lot of things drop as you get older.
You guys play piano, right?
Huh?
You play piano and you can play guitar, right?
I play piano and guitar.
Yeah, I'm not very good at it, but
so you can bring it a key down if you need to.
I'm a synthesizer player, right? So I grew up listening to Duran Duran. I was a huge fan of Nick Rhodes, and Nick Rhodes is a synth player. I mean, what I think that this piano playing I did tonight was the first time I've ever played live and sang since I was 25. So that's 25 years ago.
Wow.
So, but you know what you guys have kind of made me discover is that I kind of like doing this. I think it might be something I might start doing. So thank you very much for introducing me back.
Well, I'm hearing that. Even John Milkey was like, you're inspiring me to want to do things too. He's got a lot of podcasts and stuff that he's got going on. And apparently I'm inspiring people. So
that's what we got to do. That's what it's all about. That's we're gonna go down in history during this time for this year. I mean,
I mean,
people that are positive,
I think people are realizing how much music is an integral part of their life, right? And like, even you know, and a lot of people don't think the arts industry is a viable, but it's like the fourth largest industry in this country. But like, what would people be doing right now if they couldn't watch movies and programs and listen to music? I mean, it's you know, I really hope the world changes in a positive direction from this, because if we don't learn from this, I don't know what we'll never learn.
And there's been so many movies where they've seen it coming.
You know what? I'm going to tell you some weird story, and Michael can attest to this because he's over there. And if he wants to come over, Michael, you can come over, actually. Come on over. So so the one thing I want to...
Are you bringing on Santa Michael?
He's not in Santa suit. Come on over, Mike.
Oh.
Do you want to, Michael?
He wants.
You don't have to.
He can bring Charlie Bird.
Drake is so bossy all the time.
Hold on one second. He needs to adorn himself. He's like Miss Horizon. She won't come on without everything done.
Yes,
you're so bossy.
I wasn't ready. No, I'm kidding.
So I'll preface this. I'll tell you this story. So I was in Washington, D.C. 2 months ago this is a really special project that's going to be happening. I know the person that's producing this special project is watching, and I'm not allowed to talk about it. It's killing me that I can't announce what's happening. But anyway, so I'm not going to announce it now because it's going to be big, and it's going to be the highlight of my life.
Woo!
But next to marrying my husband. So what happened was I came home from D.C. after being on a plane, and I seen a lot of people coming from China with masks on, and I was very afraid. And so I got home and I turned on Netflix, and there's this documentary. What's the name of it? It's not Contagion.
Yeah, there's several of them on Netflix now.
Yeah, so I started to play it, And I shut it right off. And I mean, you know, I always love medical stuff because one of my aspirations was to be a paramedic until my back got bad and I couldn't do it. Yeah. And so Michael and I were there.
That's so funny. That's what I wanted to do too, Drake. I never knew that. That's
yeah,
so crazy.
It's interesting. And so
I just wanted to drive the ambulance and turn on the sirens.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Yeah. It's just such a
move
G.I.
out
Joe
of the way.
It's such a G.I. Joe thing to do. So anyway, so I start watching this, and the first thing I do is see somebody tubing somebody for a ventilator, and I shut.
Hi, Michael. Sorry, Drake. Don't mean to interrupt. Okay.
So I shut it off, and Michael looked at me, and he's like, "I said I can't watch this right now," and I had a really bad premonition like feeling that this was going to happen to us.
Wow.
You can ask Michael. When I got to the airport in Detroit, I was having major anxiety. I said, Michael, I said something really bad's going to happen in the world. Did I know?
They apparently knew about this in November.
Yeah, no, I know. So
has been lying about a lot. But anyways.
Well, you know, it's interesting. George W. Bush was the one who talked about this during his presidency and say they need to prepare and be ready. Like, people have known this was coming for a long time, which it's interesting though how I never thought I would be like
here,
you know, praising George W. Bush or
is it
Rob Ford, right?
No,
Doug was the brother, right?
Doug Ford, you know, I've been a
is very Doug Ford, he's the premier of Ontario.
Yeah,
Rob was the brother, right? Okay.
I was very critical of him, but you know what? Doug Ford has done an exceptional job.
They've all stepped up. Regardless of Liberals, you know, Conservative, NDP, everybody is stepping up. They're doing the best they can, and I'm applauding them. And I also, and I'm sure you guys want to as well, I want to thank all the healthcare support workers. I want to thank all the grocery store clerks. I want to thank the ambulance and fire and police.
Truck drivers,
sanitation workers.
You know what? I really hope that people look down on jobs like that. Janitors, cleaners, and you know, these are the people that are saving our lives right now. It's like,
now that you mentioned that, Patrick, here in our condo, the lady that cleans, I mean, this building where we live, we bought a condo last year here in the eastern part of Ottawa. And the lady that cleans the building is exceptional. And every day she's in every hallway vacuuming, and she's literally risking her life. And so I opened the door, and she immediately jumped like 6 feet back. And I said, just stay there for a minute. And I put $20 on the floor, and I said, you know, take that. I said, and go get everybody coffee, get the supers coffee, get yourself coffee.
Wow, that's really nice. I said,
thank you very much for helping us and being here for us. So I would like to encourage everybody to be kind, do something very kind to somebody.
That's
well, or when you're shopping, like I do, I just say thank you when I see somebody. Yes. In a store. They're like, well, I'm like, just because what you're doing, like I wouldn't be brave enough to do that. I mean,
you know, what's always, you know, I've been always philosophical about stuff like this, but what's always amazed me is that we pay the grocery store workers like $11 an hour and we pay a hockey player $11 million. You know,
but it's funny, we didn't notice them before.
I hope it sticks though.
I hope it's one of those things that people are nice for a little while and then get out of the habit again.
My first job was at Loblaws and Elmer, and I was pack boy, so
really?
I've been there. I've worked in a grocery store
before. So you were packing it at Loblaws, yeah?
Yes. And then I was a pin chaser at the bowling alley.
Oh God! Did you hit a strike once at the bowling alley? I bet you.
Those pins are—I don't know. I mean, did you apologize to them? I don't know.
I have.
There's like tons of pins missing from the bowling alley.
My shrink knows all about them too.
I never worked in a grocery store, but I worked at Canadian Tire, and you know, for a long
time. I'm working a grocery store. It's a lot of work.
And the Hudson's Bay Company, for a long time.
Yeah, retail is.
Yeah, I mean, any retail is a lot of work, and people put up with a lot of abuse. So, yes, Andrea.
And customer service, like all those WTF, like seriously.
If I may do one shout out, I just want to.
Yeah.
I worked at Air Canada for 10 years, and I know a lot of my former colleagues there are really going through, you know, struggles again. And, you know, it's a constant in the airline industry. So I just want to send a lot of love to all the people people that do that job too now.
Disinfecting planes.
Somebody's well, just, asking.
You know, like all the flights, they're like Air Transit, WestJet, Air Canada, yeah. that are rescuing Canadians. Like,
you know that's, that should I mean, be fine right now. Like, everybody should be done. Everybody should be back home. So that should yeah. all have stopped.
Unfortunately, Michael's sister is a travel agent, and yeah. she's saying they're still having a hard time getting people.
Oh, it's not. My friend Mark is stuck in Costa Rica. He can't get out. Ouch. I mean,
at least you're just stuck here with me.
I know. It could be worse. You could be the person that's stuck with your ex-boyfriend.
God. Yeah. Charlie Bird, we put poor Charlie Bird. Charlie Bird was supposed to be on the show, but we put him away.
Oh, poor Charlie Bird.
Yeah, Charlie Bird. Charlie Bird's a celebrity on Facebook now.
Yes. Somebody's asking if you guys would do Blues Fest.
I've applied multiple times for Blues Fest and they keep declining me.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of the local events, it's very hard to get in if you're not part of the big clique, right?
Yeah.
Well, it is. You know what? And can I say one thing?
That's why I do this.
The first time in 20 years I got booked by a major country festival, Rockin' yeah. River, and now it's
canceled. I mean, and I was going to apply. Summer. I mean, Patrick shared that with me, and I was going to apply for it too, and then everything blew up. So you know, not happening.
I think our pride is next. Every other pride has been canceled. But
oh yeah, everything's going. You're not. I don't think we're going to see anything. I think we're going to have to be doing the show here. Like, we got to come back on sometime.
Yes, when we can have a lot more people too, so we can get a lot of artists.
Yeah.
If my cancer event doesn't happen, then it'll be an online cancer benefit where people can email in some donations. And
you're not going to have cancer.
Oh, what do you need? If you need any help with that, please let me know.
It was supposed to be June 6th. I was doing a cancer benefit in support for the RNs at the Canadian Cancer Center at the Ottawa Hospital.
Yeah.
Which is going to be a big drag show. It was my only cancer benefit that I'm doing. So we might have to look into possibly doing something. If we don't have Pride in August, then I will move the big cancer benefit and make it bigger and better on the net.
Awesome.
Yeah.
And then maybe
we'll set up the PayPal account so people can, you know.
And we'll give you the exclusive when we release Lost in Love.
There we go.
That would be cool.
You guys can come and sing it.
Yep.
Yes.
So excited about this song. Yeah.
Good. Well, I'm glad to hear it. Well, I look forward to seeing what you both have going. It's been an hour.
Oh my God.
Wow.
Five flies when you're having fun, boys.
Oh, well, it does. This was great.
Yes. Hey, well, thank you.
Hello, Michael. How are you?
I'm good.
Yes, Michael, are you watching all those Christmas movies happening now, or are you over it?
I wish I could, but we don't get the Hallmark Channel here in here in Canada. And
It's on W though.
W's playing all those kind of Hallmark Channel things.
Okay.
Yeah.
I used to make fun of my mom for watching those, and then at Christmas I couldn't stop.
I know.
It was like one after the other. It was like.
But then when your husband ends up in one, you have to love them then, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, and like all my girlfriends are in them too, right? They're all actors, and so funny. Yeah.
Yeah. But anyway.
Well, thank you, Drake Jensen. Thank you, Patrick Massey, so much for being here. Tina Michael, it was nice seeing you again too.
Nice seeing you too.
Thank you all for watching. We're going to go and check the rest of your comments and do some commenting. I love you all. Happy Easter. Joyeux Pauk. Merci, merci, merci. See you later, Ottawa Gatineau. Bye-bye.
Bye, everybody. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Ms. Horizon.
Oh, you are very welcome, Daddy.
Bye.